Something that interests me about you is that you propose interesting experiments. Popper is often misquoted as saying that if your theory is falsifiable, then it's scientific. It's actually the opposite. If your theory is scientific, then it's falsifiable. It's a necessary condition, but it's not a sufficient one. I could imagine a theory or a theorist who says, okay, I've predicted supersymmetry is going to come on at 14 TeV. And then it doesn't. And then they say, okay, they work away and then they say it's going to come out at 14.5 TeV. And so they're making predictions and perhaps they're even proposing experiments and then it doesn't show up. Yeah. And then they'll say 15 TeV. I'm just imagining right now.
Yes.
If that's a word. I'm imagining right now. Okay. So what makes a good experiment? What makes a good theorist who proposes good experiments? Because what I just said, I imagine isn't great science.
I can't tell when an experiment is going to work or not. I mean, that's business. I mean, sure, it's got to be testable. I mean, a theory which is not. But you see, it doesn't have to be experiments. When I talk about big stuff,
grand.
What's the biggest stuff pretty well that's ever, not the whole universe, but is these wonderful observations due to Alexia Lopez. Huge rings of galaxies. Absolutely enormous. They're so big that there wasn't enough time in the age of the universe to make them that big. When I say the age of the universe, I'm talking about the normal view about the age of the universe, which is starting with the Big Bang. My view is that there has to have been something prior to the Big Bang which would cause this. Now, this is observational. I mean, they're not experiments in the sense that Yvette's doing. I mean, you've got your lab and you observe, testing certain things that you can test in a lab. These are out there in the world and you're observing what's there. And you have to take what's given to you. But some of these effects tell you maybe something different about the universe from what you'd thought previously. And I think these rings that Alexia Lopez has seen, when she's seen, I mean, the techniques are very important, which she happened to use in order to make these observations. But apparently, I should say there are several times the diameter of the moon, you see. You're looking at, if you could actually see these rings, they would make a big thing in the sky. Really enormous. And she's found three of them, apparently. The ones that were in the news more recently. Well, first there was a ring. Actually, she found the arc. There was an arc and then a ring. And then I was in email contact with her, and she said she thinks the arc is actually another ring. So there are two rings. And I heard recently that she's found a third one. Now, these huge things were not predicted by anybody, not even by me, I should say. So although I have when I heard about them, I thought they were very exciting because they seemed to confirm the fact that there was something prior to what we believe to be our universe. And they would be something like the collisions between enormous supermassive black holes. You see, you expect to see this in the remote future. You've got galactic clusters of galaxies, and these clusters of galaxies that we see in our universe, they're so big. Well, I should say first that a galactic cluster does not expand with the unit, they remain bound. So as the universe expands, these clusters remain more or less bound. But then the stars in them gradually get swallowed by black holes, and the black holes get bigger and bigger and bigger and gulp out most of the stars. And then occasionally you get a few big black holes which will run into each other sometimes. Absolutely enormous black holes. And they will send out a signal of gravitational waves. And these gravitational waves, according to the view I'm trying to promote, will come through from the previous eon into ours. And could well trigger this, seed the galaxies which we now see. It would be an enormous effect which would trigger the creation of new galaxies. And these galaxies could be in the form of what we see as a ring. So I found her observations very exciting, because although I hadn't thought of this as an observational test, thinking about it later, it's a very good indication that there was something before the Big Bang. I'm only saying this really in the context of our conversation. There's a whole area of not so much experiment, but observation. I mean, okay, the telescopes that they make and the techniques that are used to see these rings, for instance, it's a new technique where you look at magnesium lines and you're looking at absorption lines in magnesium, and that tells you the presence of galaxies. I don't understand it fully, but they tell you the presence of the galaxy. So you don't see these rings. You see them only by the absorption lines and these magnesium, and you look at more distant quasars and the light from them, so. But all I mean is there are a lot in the way of observation. Okay, it's experiments to some degree, because you're maybe sending a satellite out there which can see effects that you wouldn't see just from sitting on the Earth. It strikes me that there's a whole other area of observational physics, which tells us something about the structure of the universe and about the contents of the universe, because I think it's the dark matter. And I have a view which I'm still not quite formalized, which has to do with how gravitons. Well, you see, you asked me about gravitons. Yes, I do believe that gravitons should be there. On the whole, one only looks at overall effects, so you don't see individual gravitons, but there's another particle, which would be the dark matter particle, which I refer to as an Erebon. I've used this term in papers. So.
I like that name very much.
Wait, sorry, repeat that name?
Erebon. Well, you see, there's Erebus or Erebos.
He's the god
of darkness. He's a very ancient, way before, he's not even a god, because the gods were more recent, you see. I don't know about
it. It was a good idea to call the party.
He was a pre-god, I think. Well, he was, I think, what was it? Chaos, yes. You see, chaos was. This isn't physics at all.
It's just a nice word.
Yes, it's a nice word. So I thought the Erebon was a good term, because it is the god of darkness. You see, and he was way there with chaos right at the beginning. You see,
as a student, I found how sometimes physicists are very good at finding very beautiful names for horrible to calculate things. Now I was so much looking forward to learning what's charm and what strangest. It sounds like wonderful. And then when I actually had to do some calculations, I was like...
Yes. Well, some of the names are dreadful, I think. I mean, dark energy, to me, is a dreadful name, because it's neither dark nor is it energy. It's certainly not energy. It's the wrong place when you put the energy momentum business. It's not in the energy. Was a certain spot in that thing, and this is not that at all. So it's certainly not energy. It's not dark. It's invisible. The dark matter suffers from the same thing. It's not dark. It's invisible. I mean, if you look at galaxies, you see dark ring. If you see a galaxy edge on, you see, maybe there will be a black line along the middle. Now, that's dark. That's dark stuff. But that's not dark matter. The dark matter, you can't see at all. It's invisible. And that's a quibble. I think dark energy is worse than a quibble. I think that really is a bad name. I just heard somebody on the radio was saying what a wonderful name it was, and he'd only thought of this, and it just fits so well and all that stuff.
I
don't know.
I wanted to say something about the experiments. I wanted to mention two experiments. I think that the comment I wanted to make is how difficult sometimes is to rule something out. So DOC came up with the idea as well. Roger and Lajos DOC came up with this idea independently, that gravity collapses the wave function. But DOC took it a step forward and wrote down a stochastic model that predicts like more the like the detail of the collapse, but it does not conserve energy. So one of the predictions of the model is this radiation that should be observed. And there's been a really beautiful experiment done underground by Catalina. Can you remind me how to pronounce her name? She's done this experiment underground. Well, with a big...
This is the heating.
Yeah.
Spontaneous heating. Yes, yes, yes.
So she's done an amazing experiment to test not only DLC's model, but a whole bunch of collapse models. And they haven't seen the signature of these models, right? So up to certain parameters, these models have been ruled out. But, you know, models usually depend on a parameter. So then you could say, well, I mean, you can't really say that's it. The models are dead because we don't see, because there could be some other scales. And so that's a bit of a difficult thing, but you were asking me like what would be like good proposals or no. And I think a little bit that, that at least you can test a big part of the parameter space in a realistic way. But yeah, we have to live with the fact that sometimes ruling out things can be very difficult. Yes, and let me mention one other example, because I find this very relevant to the discussion and also like a beautiful proposal. So Sugato Bose, a colleague of mine, who actually I used to work with him when I was here at Oxford in a junior research fellowship, he proposed an experiment. That is to test quantum gravity. So I think he builds on something that Feynman proposed before, but in a time that you didn't have the advances of the quantum technologies that we have now. And then Sugato takes it, and Sugato and colleagues take it further by kind of stating how would you do this test nowadays, right? So the idea is that you have one particle in a superposition, but not only one, you need a second particle in another superposition. So you see already the challenge that we've been talking for a long time of getting one in a superposition, and here you need two in a superposition. But anyway, so this side of the superposition you bring to get close to the other side of the superposition. And the idea is that if gravity entangles these particles, then gravity is quantum, because what the work done by them claims is that you need a quantum mediator to entangle. Now, I'm not going to comment on that because there are discussions and some people agree on if that's the case, or some people disagree on what the case, and there's a discussion. I don't want to chip in into that discussion. What I want to talk about is the course in relevance to the question that you asked me about the experiments. No? Also, we were talking about how I put my bar like really high sometimes.
Yes.
That experiment is much more difficult to do than other experiments that I proposed in the past, like the gravitational wave detector and things like that. And that's where I say like, oh, you know, like I've kind of said I'm not going to like push on this because that is really far away the line. And this is an example of an experiment that is really difficult to do, but you have a huge community working on it. And why not? I think they should be working on it, because you find creative ways to overcome hurdles and then you're successful. Like example is LIGO, right? At the beginning, there were so many sources of noise, and then the community comes together, works together, you come up with new ideas on how to solve some of the problems, and there you go, they detect the gravitational wave. So I'm very supportive of the experiment that they proposed and with the community following it, but it is a difficult one. But let's say like you have this situation. Now let's say that Diossi and Roger are right, and gravity collapses the wave function, right? So they're never, that doesn't mean that gravity is not quantum, but in my opinion, but they're never going to be able to test that if gravity collapses the wave function, because actually it happens at similar scales. So if Roger is and Diossi are correct and gravity collapses the wave function, boop, boop, they're going to, you know, collapse that superposition. and then they wouldn't see the effect proposed by Sugato and Bose and others. But that doesn't mean that what they're proposing is not there. What just would mean is that the scales at which this effect exists are still pushed to scales where there is even more difficult to see, right? Because the scales where Sugato says that these things would get entangled are the same as the ones we would expect to see the collapse of the wave function. So if collapse happens, then you don't get entanglement because the state collapsed. But the state could still be getting entangled before the collapse at other scales that are maybe more difficult to access in the experiment. So you're not ruling out. So that's the thing, is that what we're looking for doesn't rule out the other experiment. It just, so I think that's kind of an interesting thing about when is a theory completely ruled out or not? No?
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high-quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.